University of Berlin. The Nazi confiscation campaign, Degenerate Art in 1933. And this evening tonight, I will put a focus on the artist from whom were the works exhibited here in the museum. In the summer of 1937, an unprecedented campaign against modern art began in Germany. Within a few months, Nazi authorities confiscated more than 21,000 works by around 1,400 artists from about 100 museums. Modern art was thus almost completely cleared out of German museums. To this day, the collections have not recovered. And here I show you some examples of the, some examples of the confiscated works, of which you certainly know the one or the other, since they belong to the masterpieces of the German modern art at the beginning of the 20th century. Hitler had recognized early on that pictures have a strong propaganda effect, and this also applies to works of art. In order to be able to instrumentalize art for his politics, he therefore initiated the so-called Gleichschaltung, or bringing into line of the art and museum world, of the art and museum world, immediately after he came to power at the beginning of 1933. Progressive-minded professors of art academies and museum directors lost their posts and were replaced by colleagues who were loyal to the art policies of the Nazis. From several of these newly staffed offices and institutions, defamation of modern art began immediately. So-called chambers of horror were set up in which works of art were exposed to the ridicule of the public. And in many places, the undesirable art was magazined, locked away from the public. However, these were only regional actions. The Reich government did not strike a definitive blow against modernity nationwide until 1937. Hitler himself had set this deadline in one of his first speeches in February 1933. Now, German people, give us the time of 4 years and then evaluate and judge us. After Hitler's speech. And after those 4 years in 1937, Hitler seemed to have reached his goal. All institutions were largely brought in line. Germany was stabilized domestically and well on the way to economic recovery. In Berlin, Hitler had a gigantic exhibition set up under the motto of his deadline, "Give me 4 years." And here I show you the poster of this exhibition. And at the exhibition, or basically the exhibition, he wanted to show what he had achieved and that Germany had risen to become a technical, scientific, and economic superpower through his government. Foreign countries were also deeply impressed. From this strong position, the government now moved to definitely destroy modernism, ordering the systematic confiscation of modern art from all public collections as a clear signal of this. Among the artists from whom works were confiscated as degenerate art were Marc Chagall, Lazare Segal, Jakob Adler, and Paul Gangolf, whose art is presented here in the exhibition. Ladies and gentlemen, to explain the further development of the confiscation campaign, I will precede my presentation with 4 questions. From which museums were how many works by Chagall, Segal, Gangolf, and Adler confiscated? Why was their art considered degenerate? What happened to the works after confiscation, and where are the works today? And the last question is, to what extent is Cornelia Gullit connected to the events hands, although no works of her had been confiscated. Before I go into these questions, I would like to briefly introduce you to my research area at Freie Universität Berlin. There I am in charge of the research center Degenerate Art, I already mentioned it, at the Institute of Art History since 2006. The focus of my research team and me are the methods of art and cultural policy during Hitler's dictatorship, especially the previous history, the events and effects of the Degenerate Art Confiscation Campaign. In this context, we investigate the fate of artists affected, the strategies of museum directors and others involved, as well as the whereabouts of the confiscated artworks. Our main project is the processing of a database with all the works that were confiscated in 1937 as degenerate art. Each work of art is provided with an extensive documentation. Everything that has happened to the works since their acquisition by the respective museums of origin is researched. This includes, in particular, the reconstruction of the circumstances of the seizure and all subsequent changes of ownership of the artworks, if possible, up to their current locations. The written information is supplemented by historical and current photographs. Since April 2010, the researched data has been published step by step on the internet, available free of charge to any interested user in English and German. We are close to completing our research now. In our database, you can also search for the works confiscated from Chagall, Segal, Langolf, and Jankel Adler, although we have not been able to find out much about some of the works so far. And this brings me back to the topic of my talk and the first question. From which museums were how many works by the artists shown in this exhibition confiscated? Of the four artists, Marc Chagall had been the most works confiscated. This is not related to the degree of defamation, but to how many works had previously been acquired by the museums. A total of 63 works by Chagall were confiscated from 18 museums, including the museums in Essen, Frankfurt am Main, in Dresden and Berlin, as well as in Königsberg, Stuttgart, and Hamburg. At the slide, I show you photos of some of his works taken in the Nazi storages. Some of which upside down. Chagall's painting, Die Prise, or The Pinch, which the museum director Gustav Hartlaub had acquired for the Kunsthalle in Mannheim, Art Hall in Mannheim, in 1928, met a very special fate. Hartlaub was forced to resign in 1933 because of his pro-modernist attitude on art. His successor, Otto Gebele von Waldstein, a convinced Nazi Party member, organized one of the first defamation exhibitions in Germany immediately after taking office under the title Kulturbolschewistische Bilder, Cultural Bolshevik Images, in April to June 1933. As the climax of the smear campaign, he had Chagall's painting harnessed to a wagon, accompanied by a poster with a photograph of Gustav Hartlaub and details of the purchase price, which was intended to incite the taxpayer from whose money the museum were run to protest. In a kind of doomsday war, the wagon drove up to the residence of Gustav Hartlaub and his family. This early example of a regional defamation shows what was equally relevant for the German white confiscation 4 years later. Not the artists themselves, but rather the institutions and their directors, and thus above all the art policy of the white were held responsible for an assumed Jewish Bolshevik world conspiracy. Now let's get back to our four artists. Almost as many works as by Chagall were confiscated by La Zazigal. A total of 58 from 8 museums. 23 works alone came from 2 museums in Dresden, where Zagal, and you have heard it from Hubert Ports, where Zagal, who was born in Vilnius, was a master student at the Art Academy and co-founder of the Dresden Secession in 1919, alongside Otto Dix, Conrad Felix, Müller, and others. The rest of his works were seized in Wroclaw, Essen, Erfurt, Freiburg, Chemnitz, and Nuremberg. Less than half as many works by Jankel Adler were confiscated. A total of 27 from 10 museums in Berlin, Düsseldorf, Essen, Frankfurt am Main, and others. The same applies to the confiscation of works by Paul Gangolf, born in Königsberg. 26 of his works were confiscated in 4 museums in Berlin, where he was repeatedly active as an artist, as well as in Hamburg, Dresden, and Kaiserslautern. The statistics show that the works of the young avant-garde artists were distributed in a relative large number of museums throughout Germany, as it was also true for the works of all the other artists. With the beginning of the Weimar Republic, freedom of art was declared a basic maxim in clear distinction to the imperial era. From then on, contemporary art, including avant-garde movements, was the focus of official support programs. In all its diversity, modern art was seen as a symbol of democracy and was intended to lay the foundations for a modern society oriented towards social values in order to rebuild Germany as a cultural nation after the lost First World War. The museums played an important role in this. For the first time, the government supported the development of public collections of modern art. The reform took its starting point in Berlin. Here, the director of the National Gallery, Ludwig Justi, was able to open a gallery of the living in the Grundprinzipalie as early as 1919, showing mainly expressionist works, which later included works by Chagall, Segal, Adler, and Gangolf. As the capital of the German Empire, Berlin's example radiated throughout the country. Under the progressive spirit of the Weimar Republic, modern art was now able to penetrate to the furthest provinces. Federalism in Germany had a beneficial effect on this. Unlike in Great Britain or France, where the avant-garde could only be seen in the art centers of London and Paris, decentralization in Germany favored cultural dispersion. Germany's self-assertion as a cultural nation had to be strengthened not only internally, but above all, externally. In this respect, the art institutions located in peripheral regions, such as those in the cities of Breslau and Stettin, played an important role. Academies and museums were developed here to act as bulwarks against outside cultural influences, and to bind both the population and the local artists culturally to the homeland by education and by building up their own modern collections. In the course of the 12 years of the Weimar Republic, a very vivid, multivarious art scene was able to develop, with which Germany achieved international recognition. However, this was only true in art connoisseur circles. In general, many reservations about modern art remained. Only in this way could the defamation of the Nazis be successful, and the confiscation action in 1937 be carried out without any significant resistance. And that brings me to my second question. Why was modern art considered degenerate? the seizure, which was mainly carried out in the months from July to the end of October 1937, there were no clearly formulated guidelines for the selection of works. Joseph Goebbels, Reich Minister for Popular Enlightenment and Propaganda, had taken over the entire operation and for this purpose had received two so-called Führererlasse from Hitler ordering the seizure of works of German degenerate art since 1910. It was not until November 1937 that Goebbels had a brochure published describing nine groups of degenerate art. Group one concerned the works whose form and color scheme did not conform to the academic rules of realistic art. Group two concerns depiction of religious content. Group three and four were related to political and socially critical representations. Group five concerned the allegedly immoral depictions of women as living ladies or prostitutes. Group six were related to depictions of minorities, and group seven related to depictions of allegedly insane figures. Group eight concerned the artworks by Jews. And here you can find the painting by Marc Chagall again. And group nine, the last group, was considered to the abstract art. When compared with the Nazi criteria, the works of Chagall, Segal, Adler, and Gangolf belong to several groups at once, whereby the Jewish origin of Chagall, Segal, and Adler particularly weighed heavily. As can easily be seen from the wording, the argumentation was not conducted on an aesthetic or art historical level, but in terms of the Nazi racial ideology. This also explains the preference for the biological concept of degeneration, which was not introduced into art criticism by the Nazis, but which was systematically used during the Third Reich to manipulate the understanding of art. It evokes the idea of a serious disease that must inevitably be fought. And this raises the third question. What happened to the works after confiscation and where are they today? Around 120 works were intended for an exhibition that was shown, 720 works were intended for an exhibition that was shown under the motto-giving title Degenerate Art in Munich from July 19 to the end of November 1937. This exhibition was the actual reason for the confiscation because Goebbels wanted to use the display of what he considered to be highly degenerate to create a counterexample to the great German art exhibition, which had opened one day earlier on July 18 in the newly built Haus der Deutschen Kunst. For this, contemporary artists who were considered to be in line with the Nazis had submitted current works. However, these did not correspond to the quality expected by Goebbels and Hitler. And so an attempt was made to present the works of art in the Haus der Deutschen Kunst in a more positive light through the negative examples in the Degenerate Art exhibition in the near vicinity. Unlike in the nobly furnished rooms of the Haus der Deutschen Kunst, the works in the Degenerate Art exhibition hung tightly packed next to and on top of each other. This created an impression of chaos and disorder in which the individual work of art was lost. On the walls were guiding sentences such as "crazy at any price" or "this is how sick minds look at nature." Under almost every work there was a red slip of paper with the inscription "paid from the tax pennies of the working German people." The public could hardly escape the staging and was strongly influenced in the formation of its opinion. exhibition also featured the paintings by Chagall, Segal, and Adler. In Munich, approximately 2 million visitors are said to have seen the exhibition. Due to its perceived success, the show was subsequently toured to numerous other German and Austrian cities. During the tour, the profile of the exhibition changed as the exhibits' works exchanged. The attack on modern art became increasingly politicized. The composition and presentation of the works aimed at a clearer formulation of racial and anti-communist enemy images in order to provide arguments for the persecution of minorities and thus support the preparation of the Eastern campaign. After the confiscation, all works were brought to Berlin to a grain silo in Kreuzberg district. On 13 January 1938, Hitler visited the silo. Josef Goebbels, who had accompanied Hitler, noted in his diary, quote, "viewed the stacked documents of degenerate art with the Führer. For 2 hours, the result was devastating. No painting met with mercy," end of quote. Thus, the judgment had been passed. The works were declared quasi outlawed, and they no longer had housing in Germany. That had not been intended from the beginning. Initially, it was only planned to remove them from public view. But now, with Hitler's judgment, it was decided to get rid of the works for good, to exploit or utilize them. On May 31, 1938, the law about the confiscation of products of degenerate art was passed, which decreed the withdrawal from the museum without compensation, and thus legally prepared for utilization of degenerate art. The commission, headed by Goebbels, divided the degenerate art into 6 groups. Approximately 3,000 works were considered internationally exploitable and were to be sold abroad for foreign currency. Furthermore, there were 2 groups that were intended for exhibition and propaganda purposes. A stock of nearly 1,000 works remained in the cellar of the Ministry of Propaganda in Berlin, the purpose of which is not known to this day. A good 180 works were returned for diplomatic reasons. The rest, around 5,000 works, were declared unsellable and burned in the courtyard of Berlin's main fire station in 1939, including 4 fine prints by Chagall, 1 painting and 22 fine prints by Segal, 3 watercolors, 4 paintings, and 1 fine print by Adler, and 11 fine prints by Paul Gangold. The internationally sellable works were moved to a castle in northern Berlin to prepare them for sale. To kick off the sale, an auction of 125 masterpieces from the confiscated holdings was held in June 1939 in Lucerne, neutral Switzerland, organized by Swiss gallery owner Theodor Fischer, who was also deeply involved in the trade of looted art from the occupied territories. Later on, 1 watercolor and 2 paintings by Chagall were sold at the auction. The aforementioned painting, The Pinch, from the Kunsthalle in Mannheim, together with a watercolor, came to the Swiss Art Museum in Basel. The other painting was acquired by the Belgian Museum in Liège. The remaining works, stored in the chateau or in the castle, were to be sold individually by art dealers. 4 dealers were mainly authorized by this purpose: Ferdinand Möller and Karl Buchholz from Berlin, Bernhard Alois Böhmer from Güstrow in northern Germany, and Hildemann Gurlitt from Hamburg. At this point, I come to answer my last question, in which way Cornelia Gurlitt was connected to the events. Cornelia was Hildemann's sister, and you heard these aspects, of course, from Hubert Ports. Although she died early in 1919, the influence on her brother has much to do with his professional career up to the years when he acted as a dealer of degenerate art. Hildebrand Bullet was born in 1895 into a wide-ranging family of archaeologists, philosophers, composers, artists, and art historians. His grandfather, Louis Bullet, was a painter, and his father, Cornelius Gustav Bullet, was a professor of architectural history at the Technical University in Dresden, where the family lived. As a child of 11 years, Hildebrand encountered modern art when he met a few of the Brücke painters, who started as architecture students of his father and later initiated Expressionism in Germany. But above all, it was his beloved sister Cornelia who taught him about Expressionism. Cornelia was 5 years older than Hildebrand and had trained as a painter in Dresden. She had turned to Expressionism early on. During the First World War, she was working as a Red Cross nurse, or as a nurse in a Red Cross hospital in Vilnius. As often as Cornelia could find time, she drew and painted the Baltic landscape, the Jewish people, and her daily routine in hospital with wounded soldiers. And here I'll show you a portrait of Hildebrand painted by Cornelia in 1914 and a lithograph from 1917. Hildebrand was stationed in Vilnius near his sister too. Of the end of 1917, he worked for the press department there. His job was to make propaganda for German culture in the conquered Eastern territories. Here, the two Bullet siblings met several German artists, art historians, and art critics who were working in the press department as well, including Paul Fechter, a Berlin-based journalist specialized on Expressionism, and Karl Schmidt-Rottler, one of the Brücke painters. After the end of the Second World War, Bullet studied art history and expanded his contacts with avant-garde artists such as Conrad Felix Müller, Otto Dix, and Lazar Segal, who founded the Dresden Secession. Bullet visited the artists in their studios, attended art events, joined progressive artist groups, and tried to promote them by writing articles about Expressionism in several newspapers and art magazines. In the mid-1920s, Bullet started a career as a museum director in Zwickau, a small industrial town in eastern Germany, where he wanted to introduce modern art to the art-averse population in the spirit of the Weimar Republic's popular education movement. In 1931, he moved to Hamburg and continued his ambitious work there at the city's Kunstverein, or Art Association. In both places, Hildebrand Bullet was strongly criticized by right-wing nationalist circles for his pro-modernist approach to art, which is why he finally had to leave his two posts. He then changed into the art trade in 1933, and 2 years later founded his Hamburg Kunstkabinett, his gallery in Hamburg, where he continued to show modern artists until 1937. Around that time, the situation in Nazi Germany became hairy for him, not only because of his modern art promotion, but because of his descent. In 1935, the so-called Nuremberg race laws had been enacted, and all members of the Reichskulturkammer, Reich Chamber of Culture, where Hildebrand Bullet had to be registered as an art dealer, had to provide a certificate of Aryan descent. Due to the Nuremberg laws, Hildebrand Bullet was considered quarter Jewish because his paternal grandmother was Jewish. Caught in this situation, he offered his services to the propaganda ministry as a dealer of degenerate art, since it was known that one can hope for protection from persecution if one brought in a lot of foreign currency with one's business dealings. The other three dealers in degenerate art that I briefly mentioned earlier were committed to promoting modern art during the Weimar Republic. None of them, however, was of Jewish descent like Gurlitt. This may be one reason why Gurlitt thus by far exceeded the acquisitions of his colleagues. While he took over in total 3,879 items, Böhmer took only 1,187, Buchholz 883, and Müller 848. Today, the names of the dealers are known only in expert circles, except that of Gurlitt. 10 years ago, his name became famous overnight through media stories around the world with the unexpected discovery of the so-called Munich Art Trove. In February 2012, over 1,500 works were found in Munich, where the collection was kept in secret by Hildebrand Gurlitt's aged son Cornelius. Among them were around 500 works by Kirchner, Heckel, Kandinsky, Beckmann, and other modern masters stemming from the confiscation campaign in 1937. Like all three other art dealers, Gurlitt had violated the rules of the Ministry of Propaganda and sold only a portion of the works he had taken over abroad, while secretly reselling most of them to German collectors or keeping them for himself, hoping to be able to sell them under better conditions in later times, which came true in the years after the Second World War, when modern works of art were highly desired by museum directors to fill the gaps that the confiscation campaign in 1937 had torn in their collections. Thus, the Nazi goal of banishing modern art from that time from Germany forever was not fulfilled. However, I would not call the art dealers saviors or even heroes, since they certainly profited from the Nazi system, and their motivations are difficult to judge from the distance of the time. Thank you for your attention.